Good afternoon, everyone. This is Brother Lloyd. And as always, to those who are keeping the Sabbath today, Shabbat Shalom. Now, today's lesson titled Liar, Liar is really a continuance on from the video I did last week about gossiping and backbiting, because really a lot of times you can't have those types of things going on without some lying mixed in with it to embellish it and make it a greater story than it actually is. But we're going to talk about the lying aspect today and see what the Father and His Word has to say about this, because we need to understand how serious of a matter lying is. So with that, first we're going to go back to Proverbs 6, 16, 17, and 19. And we're going to start with verse 16. And it reads, "These six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto Him: a proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood." In verse 19, "A false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among brethren." So keep those three scriptures in mind, especially the 17 and 19, which says a lying tongue and a false witness that speaketh lies. So here's some questions. Do you know anyone who drives you crazy with their lying ways? Do you know someone who lies so much that you don't trust them? Do you know someone who is a habitual liar? And the fourth question, what about that person that every time they open their mouth, the first thought that goes to your head is, here comes another lie? I'm sure plenty of you do, but yet so many of you choose to have these people as close associations. And I mean very close associations, like best friend, boyfriend, girlfriend, hangout buddies, or even, of course, the ones we have no choice in, which is family members. Oh, let's not forget the husband and the wife. And the problem is, we choose them, so we can't claim the ignorance excuse on that one. See, if you can sleep with somebody and do all the things you do, and then marry them, because everyone's doing it backwards, so you're doing all that first, and then you marry them, you should at least know whether they're a liar before you get that involved to cry about it later about having a liar as a husband or a wife. That's a you issue. You chose that. So, here's a big question. Do any of these statements really describe you? See, you can hear all this, and you start thinking about all these other people you know, or married to, or dating, or whatever, but you might be that person. So really, turn around, look in the mirror, ask yourself that question, is this me? Admit it to yourself or not, but that's the reality of it. So, in all that, you might be the person that everyone else talks and gossips about because of your lying ways. And the problem is, lying or a liar can perpetuate more sin by creating gossipers and backbiters. See, lying does all this stuff, and usually that's how a lot of this starts off. And this just leads right back into what? Our associations, because that's what it's all about, our associations with others. 1 Corinthians 15:11 reads like this. It says, But now I have written unto you not to keep company if any man that is called a brother be a fornicator or a covetous or an idolater or a railer or a drunkard or an extortioner with such an one, no, not to eat. For what have I to do to judge them also that are without? Do not ye judge them that are within, but them that are without God judgeth. Therefore, put away from among yourselves that wicked person. See, this is talking about associations and not involving yourself with these type people. And that includes liars. Now, in Deuteronomy 13:5, we're told that false speaking turns us away from the Father. This chapter in particular was talking about false prophets and dreamers of dreams. Now, with them being false teachers and not being of the Father was cause for them what? To be stoned to death. See, so as a reference, it illustrates how serious lying is. Lies serve to turn us away from the Father, and He's not going to be dealing with liars kindly. In 1 Corinthians 15:33, it simply tells us, evil communications corrupt good manners. Do you not think that a liar is wicked, filled with evil communication is spread? And all that's going to do is corrupt people and thoughts and things. As people listen to lies, does it not set off all sorts of chaos and corruption and drama and distraction? But yet, Some of you have all these type people as close friends, associates, and like I said, the ones we can't choose, family members. Now, we don't choose family, but some people don't understand how to cut people off, especially if they're family members. So you can eliminate all this kind of stuff out your life. So in a simple sense, regardless of who it is, you dictate a lot of things that control this. You dictate your availability to socialize with someone, what you talk about in conversation, your gatherings, time spent with whomever, and even in settings in which you present yourself to do a lot of these things in, and you control all this, so you can minimize your involvement or not be involved at all to eliminate being around a bunch of gossiping and lying and backbiting. You can easily walk away. Don't let this stuff start going in and become intriguing enough to keep you involved, because once you start listening, you become a part of it and it starts to corrupt you. See, we're not going to win any of this trying to deal with being in the middle of the lion's den. Oh, I can deal with that. Oh, no, you can't. Eventually, it will corrupt you. So we have to learn how to remove ourselves from conversation and situations that aren't appropriate according to who we are, what we claim to believe, and how we will be perceived. See, because those who are of this negativity, they already know what we're claiming to stand for. And as soon as they see us become involved, it reinforces all the falseness and lies and everything that they stand on, and they look at us no different. And then on top of that, all others who claim to believe, they look at them as the same. So they look at all of us as the same. So we really have to pay attention and work to eliminate our involvements with corrupt people, liars, gossipers, backbiters, cheaters, etc. This shows your character to them, and it shows your character to the Father. And it shows them what we stand for, and that we are going to stand for what we believe. Or you can just keep on going because you fear losing, you know, something that's more important than your own moral character. You know, losing a friend or losing closeness with someone you work with or whatever. You can hang on to that if you choose, but you will be corrupted. Now, Psalms 120 verse 3 reads like this: "What shall be given unto thee, or what shall be done unto thee, thou false tongue?" Or you can simply look at it like this: what does a lying tongue gain or benefit you? Now, we're going to go back in scripture, and we're going to talk about the story of Ananias and Sapphira. And hopefully, you know who they are. And if not, that just means you need to knock some of that dust off your Bible and start opening it and reading it, because these valuable lessons are in there. They were literal then, but they were learning lessons for us today. That's why they're there. So you need to start reading your scriptures and develop and build your relationship with the Father. Father, you can't keep listening to us out here that are doing studies and claim anything because you're not confirming it based on the Word. You need to confirm it based on the Word. There are many people out here that are deceiving you, and if you never open your scriptures to prove all things, you may fall victim to some deception. So we're going to go back, and at the end of chapter 4 is where it starts. So during this time, it starts with the description of the early church in Jerusalem. And during this period, there was a group of believers that were so filled with the Holy Spirit that they were of one mind and one heart. They were really true believers. Now, there was great power and grace on the apostles at this time, which included Paul and John, who preached, taught, and they testified of our risen Savior. They were so close in their hearts that they held all their possessions loosely, and they willingly shared them with one another. They weren't coerced. They did this because they had free will and they chose to do it. And that's just how much they loved each other. They did it simply because they loved each other and they believed in the Father's word. So what they did was they sold their land and the houses, and they gave all the profits to the apostles. And what the apostles did was they distributed to those who were in need. Now, Joseph was a Levite from Cyprus. So, and what he did was he sold a field and he laid his proceeds at the feet of the apostles, who were the elders or who were the leaders of the church in Jerusalem. So here comes Ananias and Sapphira. They were two of that group. And what they did was they had a field that they sold. Now, part of the profits from the sale they kept, back for themselves, and Ananias kept back from himself, and he laid the rest at the feet of the apostles. Now his wife was in cahoots. Sapphira was in cahoots. She knew all about this, so it wasn't a secret to her. So she knew what was going on. But at this time, Ananias, he laid all the proceeds at the feet of the apostles. Now, let's go back to Acts 5 and verses 3 and 4. And we're going to read what Peter had to say, because it's really important that we understand what's going on. Verse 3, it reads, "But Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? While it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God." Now, this part right here is a perfect illustration of someone trying to straddle a fence and play both sides to satisfy self, but not truly make a choice. People, I'm telling you, you are either on one side or the other. If you try and play both sides, the Father will call you out in the end, because if you're quote unquote straddling the fence, you're working for the enemy, and the Father's going to call you out. You either have to serve one or the other. Now, in verse 5, when Ananias heard these words, he dropped dead. They picked up his body, carried him out, and they buried him. And about 3 hours later, his wife shows up to Peter. Now, she didn't know what had transpired in the meantime, but here she comes. Now it's her turn. She has opportunity to do right. And Peter asked her what she and her husband sold the land for, and she lied. She did not give him the whole truth. She lied. Verses 9 and 10 read like this. "Then Peter said unto her, How is it that ye have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband are at the door, and shall carry thee out. Then she fell down straightway at his feet and yielded up the ghost. And the young men came in and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her by her husband." Well, at least she got buried by her husband. The two liars were buried together. Look, this is a very serious matter. The Father will not play. They lied, and they paid for it with their lies. It was just a little lie, some people might say today. But we are shown that this is a serious matter, and the Father is serious when it comes to dealing with Him. The Father was showing them then, and us today, a direct, literal illustration of how much He hates sin. And what it can, and showing us what it can cost us. It wasn't about a nickel or a dime or a few dollars here or there. It was about the sin that the Father abhors. He hates sin. Peter lied. We know Peter lied too. People say, well, Peter lied. Yeah, Peter lied about knowing the Savior, what, 3 times before his crucifixion. And Ananias and his wife failed, though, to realize that they were making a direct attempt to deceive the Father. They were trying to deceive the Father Himself. Through what? Through the Holy Spirit. See, they forgot or didn't realize that the awareness was that much more intense at the time. They were trying to lie directly to the Holy Spirit, to the Father. This particular sin of hypocrisy and an attempt to deceive the Father showed the contempt that Ananias and his wife viewed the nature of and character of the Father. They viewed him with that kind of a contempt that they would actually go in and try and really lie directly to him. That's what they were trying to do. And furthermore, it showed that they had no concept of the power of the Father to see what? To see their hearts. See, and then here I go again, that illustration that this is showing us that the Father sees our hearts, sees what's going on in there. So we can't lie to him. We lie to each other all day long, but we can't lie to him. Now, scripture tells us he hates liars, and that his anger, what? It is kindled, it burns against the wicked every day. And those that plot evil in their hearts will be destroyed, if not now, in the end. So don't take that slackness, or consider it slackness, as a weakness, because those who are going to have to pay will pay. This drastic example needs to serve as a warning to believers and non-believers of the Father for then and for now. But more importantly, it shows what? that your unbelief will be exposed at some point. If you are an unbeliever, you can lie, front, conceive anything you want, but it will be exposed at some point. And that's what he did with Ananias and Sapphira. Remember, they were with this group, so they were all supposed to be believers. But what? He exposed them. See, this type of hypocrisy is among all of us every day. It is a true corrupting deception that misleads and causes chaos among believers in the world and non-believers that are in the world. It's worse among non-believers because they have no barometer or anything to weigh it against. So they are truly in the midst of this type of corruption. See, so we need to look at what our friends, we need to look in our workplace, we even need to look in our homes or any place that there is a repetitiveness of lying involved. Wherever you know there is lying involved, you really need to take a look at that because this stuff is very dangerous. See, Peter asked Ananias in verse 3 about Satan because he was making a point for them and for us that we need to understand the influence and heart. See, if you are a liar, or at least know one, and I'm sure you do understand this. John 8:44 reads like this. It says, "Ye are of your father the devil, and lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it." So what they're saying is, if you are a liar, you are a child of the enemy himself. He's the father of lies. And if you're that type of person, or if you know these type of people that are lying, they are of the devil himself. This is what the Father's word said. He is a liar. There's never any truth in him. And there's never going to be any truth in him. So this is a very serious and dangerous thing. And the Father takes it that serious because it comes directly from the enemy himself. And with that, finally understand this. I'm going to give you three scriptures. And I know there are many more, but here are three scriptures to help you recognize a liar and decide if you're one yourself and need to work on self. Because if you're one yourself, you can work on that. You can come from that. So understand this. 1 John 2:4. Let's go there. It reads, it says, "He that saith, I know him," speaking of the Father, "he that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him." Very simple, very clear. 1 John 2:22. "Who is a liar but he that denieth Jesus is the Christ?" He is Antichrist that denieth the Father and the Son. They are a liar. That's according to the word. And finally, 1 John 4:20. "If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he have not seen?" Liar. See, people claim to love people all day, every day. "But I don't believe in God. I don't believe in all that nonsense, this, any other." Remember, the Father hates a liar and says that Satan is the father of it. It is the same sin that caused Adam and Eve to betray the trust the Father had in them. It's the same betrayal that many of us have fallen victim to every day to satisfy our own selves and desires, just like Ananias and Sapphira. See, why a person lies is a relatively easy answer. It's always selfishness. Even if, sadly, they claim they're doing it for someone else or for some reason to benefit someone else, be it in life or death or what have you, it is still a selfishness. The Father never tells us to lie for any reason. He says to have faith, trust in him, let him carry our burdens, believe that he will provide for us. All these things, he says, give it to him. He didn't say lie because we're trying to fix and handle it ourselves. We have to do all these things faithfully and believe and trust in him and his word. And with that, this is Brother Lloyd. As always, move your toes out of the way, check your feelings at the play button, and listen to what the Father's word has to say. I'm out.